Hello and welcome to the Lancaster Hi-Fi YouTube channel. Today I'm going to be talking about my Magnavox Amp 185 AA, which I have modified according to the Dave Gillespie mods designed for the Magnavox 8800 series. The 8800 series also being a 6V6 push-pull amplifier design. I've modified mine slightly from Gillespie's mods to incorporate the preamp that was already on the Amp 185. Most people who use the Gillespie mods for something other than the 8800 use an Amp 175, which is the same chassis. It just doesn't have the built-in preamp. So this one uses a 7025 preamp tube, which is a low noise version of the 12AX7. It uses two 12AX7s on the input and phase splitter stages. Actually, it uses a paraphase splitter. Anyway, uses 12AX7 tubes for the triodes and 6V6 tubes for the output stage, 5U4GB rectifier tube. Now, you will notice that there are no output tubes in there. I took them out to test another amp build, and then I got new tubes for that build, and now I need to put the tubes back, but I did some tube shuffling during that amp build and testing, trying to find the best set of four 6V6s that I had on hand. So now I still have that set of four isolated, but they are not necessarily the same tubes as I took out of here. So in order to put that best set of four 6V6 tubes that I isolated into this amplifier, I need to reset the bias. And in order to reset the bias, I actually have to take the bottom off. Now, I do recall that I'm using the tuner power jack thingy right here. I can probe the various voltages here, although I can check the voltages from the top. I can't set the screws from the top. So, I'm going to have to take the bottom off and do that. Well, I've kind of developed a bit of a system for putting these things up on their sides. You know, it doesn't have a real good way to sit up on its side without help. It'd be very unstable, especially if you need to have the tubes actually in the sockets. You certainly don't want it falling over and smashing the tubes by accident, because those are expensive, and then you've got a mess, and oh dear. So my method here involves a bar clamp, but in order to employ the bar clamp, I'm gonna have to take the bottom off first. So I'll use this at the outset. It's not like there's too much scratchy stuff on this bench top, but I just wanna protect that nice finish there. Now, tilt it so that the heaviest bit, which is the power transformer, is on that downside, so it's a little less ridiculously unstable at the outset. Put another piece of wood, in this case another child's block. These end wood pieces are made from my kid's old block set. This is another one of those. I commonly employ my kid's old blocks for these purposes. This isn't going to be quite high enough. Need to find another scrap of wood to put under there. I'm resting it on the power transformer there. Well, now that I've got it tilted up, I need to turn it around. You know what? I'm just gonna go ahead and take out that rectifier tube because it's making me nervous. Okay, here we've got the back side, the bottom side, that is. Painted nice glossy black. Unfortunately, also picks up fingerprints. Probably from when I handled it before it was totally dry. These screws holding on the feet are also holding the bottom on. Through there's a little L bend in the side there. So these screws go through the feet, through the masonite bottom here, which is salvaged from the original console, through the steel and into the hardwood there. One of the reasons I use a bar clamp is because once I take this off, it'll still be resting on that wood, but it won't be attached to the wood. So I want to have the bar clamp in order to make sure everything stays stable and together and doesn't sort of slide off of that piece of wood and cause problems. I do still have three tubes in there. I want to ensure that this whole thing doesn't fall over, even though the most vulnerable of them, the big rectifier tube, has been removed. Okay, bottom's off. This piece is just sitting there, so I'll go ahead and take that off so that it's not in danger of falling off. So usually for the bar clamp, I'm using a different piece of wood other than one this thick. So I think I'm just going to stick with that and take out the finished piece here. And here's the scrap of wood that I commonly use for this purpose. Now I don't need the microfiber towel there anymore. Put this like that. Like there's another scrap of wood that should be around here somewhere. There it is. Like so, and bar clamp. So if the bar clamp is holding these pieces of wood together firmly enough, it's essentially sandwiching this metal piece here, holding it together, and then the bar clamp has that long bit to provide stability. Good, okay. So now that's pretty stable, and now I can work on it. And I can see here that I have labeled these terminals here, which are being used simply as places to measure. Okay, so here's the schematic for one channel of the main amp. And we can see the various test points on here. Here's the test point red for the bias, and the test point bias black. So we're gonna want to adjust this bias pot here to get this point should be at 6.2 volts, this point should be at 18.2 volts. That means that when across the test points, we want 12 volts difference. And then the DC balance test points are here, right at the cathodes of the output tubes. And we adjust this pot down here to get 0 volts. Between. Now, before I do any of those adjustments, of course, I have to put the tubes in. And in order to do that, I'm going to go ahead and turn it around so I'm not trying to work where I can't see what I'm doing. Put in the rectifier tube first. It's right here at hand. As with all this nice steel and glass, it's nice to have it shiny and clean. I also have the four 6V6 tubes right here. I believe these are the ones. One of them's already labeled with a 4, which means I used to have it in this spot. So and this one labeled with a 3, which means I had it in this spot. And the other two are not labeled. Maybe that if I use the original number 4 and the original number 3, that the bias will already be correct there. And interesting, these, they don't match exactly. They're both Magnavox branded, which I believe means that they're Sylvania made. So I think it's Sylvania that made tubes for a lot of the console and so on manufacturers that branded their own tubes, or that branded the Sylvania tubes. Okay. Okay, that's all tubes in place. Turn it back around. Now you can see the back panel here. Got an IEC plug for the power input, a toggle switch here for on and off, and a fuse holder. And then of course the speaker jacks here. You might be able to barely see that I've actually labeled these various things with Letraset letters. It didn't work all that well. Not enough for me to want to try those same letter sets on others, because they're just really, really ancient and didn't seem to work very well in this case. These are labeled for DC balance adjust. And then these are labeled bias adjust for channel 1 and channel 2. These must be for the so-called AC balance adjust. The idea with those is to adjust to minimize the distortion. Essentially minimizing for the effect of the crossover in the push-pull system. Since I don't have a distortion analyzer, I have simply set those to their halfway points. I might be able to use the scope to at least get a reasonable adjustment on those, or at least see whether the adjustment is visually reasonable. I've scrunched up a power cord. I'm also going to need to attach the dummy load to the outputs here. It might be fine. I think it's designed to be okay without a load attached, but not all designs are, and so when working with tube amps, generally want to get into the habit of always connecting a dummy load up to the speaker terminals before you turn it on. My super sophisticated dummy load, which is heater coil, there is a potential problem with using this as a dummy load in that applying a lot of power will heat these heater coils up significantly. When metal heats up, its resistance increases. So no real harm in using this, although there is a potential fire hazard or burn hazard when applying a lot of power to it, but I'm not going to be applying any power to it. In fact, I'll be grounding the inputs. It reminds me that it's maybe interesting to mention a peculiarity of this amplifier. Since I'm using a single tube behind this shield here for the preamp, it ends up being an inverting amplifier. And so when I attach actual speakers to the speaker terminals, I actually put the red wire on the black and vice versa, so that the output is then re-inverted back to its uninverted original form. Now, most people will say inverted, uninverted, BFD, you can't really tell the difference. Some people claim to be able to hear the difference. I'm not one of those people who claims to be able to hear the difference, but it doesn't do any harm to put the output into its uninverted form. Of course, the leads that I made for these aren't long enough to rest this back down onto the table. It's a bit of a pain in the butt. And I also don't want to short the coils by leaning them against steel or something, so it can be a bit of a trick to figure out exactly where to place this thing. And the last thing before I turn it on is to put in these grounding plugs. These are my homemade plugs for grounding the inputs, and they're simply sticking one into the wire, soldering it down into the end of the jack there, and then bringing the other end over, bending it over, and soldering it to the outside. Okay, and then I've got this up on the block up here. Keep it kind of out of the way, and also keep the coils from touching the steel. Now, time to turn it on and hope no smoke comes out. Just to measure DC voltage. And first we'll do the bias adjustment. Channel 2, just because it's easier to reach. Okay, so we can see out of the gate that we're at 11.8 volts. So it looks like there's not a lot of adjustment that needs to be done. That's cool. Things can change as the system gets warmer, so I'm going to start with the bias adjustment, keeping in mind that I may have to adjust on the fly and readjust as the system warms up farther. Let's see how close to 12.0 volts I can get. I am at 12.0 volts right now, of course. 12.00, that's even nicer, isn't it? Switch to the other channel. The current on one channel can depend on the current on the other channel as well. Okay, so this one's at 11.8 volts, similar to where the other one started, 12.0 volts. I should say that when I hear people talk about tube rolling, it makes me cringe for this reason, that as soon as you change tubes, even if they're matched and all that, which they always kind of should be, but these aren't pre-matched, you have to adjust the bias and the balance and blah, blah, blah. And so any difference that you hear may be due to the system being out of whack once you so-called roll the tubes. So I don't necessarily recommend tube rolling because it's kind of a pain in the ass. As soon as you change the tubes, you've got to adjust the bias. Now, in the amplifier builds that I've done after this one, this is my first rebuild. I have made it so that you can adjust the bias from the top by drilling holes in the steel. In this case, I wasn't confident in my ability or even maybe particularly able, didn't necessarily have the right tools to drill holes in the steel. So I made it so that you had to adjust it from the bottom, which means you got to take the back off. Would have been a lot easier if I'd made the holes, and I could still do that, I guess, but yeah, don't really want to try that now. It would involve a lot of soldering and unsoldering, soldering again, and so on. Now that I did that one for that channel, let me recheck channel 2. All right, that seems to still be pretty right on. Let me just inch it down a smidgen. All right, that's good. Check the other one again. 11.99. 12.00. Okay, so now DC balance, I'm making each channel draw equal current from the two in the pair of tubes for that channel. So I'll do channel 2 first, and this is the one where I want 0 volts measured across these terminals. So 2 millivolts, that's very close to zero. DC balance adjustments are here and here. All right, that's less than a millivolt. That should be just fine. Let me recheck bias on that channel. Coming in low now. So as you can see, this is kind of an iterative process. You change one thing, it can affect the other thing, and you have to kind of keep going through the adjustments until you're not having to adjust anymore and everything stays where it should be. One of the mental adjustments that you have to make when you doing this is to keep track of which pots are more sensitive. So these for the bias adjustment are 20 turn pots, but the ones for the DC balance are, I believe, only 1 turn pots, so they're very sensitive to small changes, whereas these you really need to crank. All right, I'll recheck those before I put the back on. Let's talk about measuring the AC balance to minimize distortion. That requires me to input a signal, to look at the distortion of that signal by the amplifier, and to minimize that distortion with the pots here and here for the two channels. It says adjust AC balance for minimum total harmonic distortion at 1 watt at 1 kilohertz. Okay, AC balance for minimum total harmonic distortion at 10 watts at 1 kilohertz. 10 watts, that's a lot. What I'll be doing is comparing the signal in to the signal out. I need to check the difference between the input and the output. Now I can check the literal difference, but that's not necessarily going to work because the input and output are going to be at different voltage levels. So what I think I'm going to do is look at A versus B mode, in which I ought to get a straight line on the scope trace. And I'd be shooting for the straightest line I can get. So let's see how that goes. All right, so I brought the camera in closer for a better view of the scope, etc. So I've got the scope probes so that A is on the output of channel 2, which is the right channel, and B is on the input to the main amp stage of this amplifier. So that's downstream of the preamp. The preamp has its own feedback and so on, and so there's no adjustment that I can hope to do there. Now, it's right now at a very low level. Right now it's only at 20 millivolts per division on both channels, just to illustrate the gain in the power amp stage. But this is very low level. Let's see, I need to work out what output I need here. All right, power is voltage squared over resistance. Voltage squared equals power times resistance. And voltage then needs to equal the square root of power times resistance. 10 watts at 8 ohms. That's 10 times 8. Square root of 80. What row? What's the square root of 80? So the voltage I need is 8.94. Right now it's only at 23 millivolts. Oh dear. I maxed out the volume on the phone and the amp. Looks like in order to get to 10 watts, I'm gonna need that Kinter amp after all. I'm recalling now that I think I made some calculation errors in designing that preamp stage, because I wanted to have that preamp stage so that I could get to full scale volume with a phone. Oh well, I'll get that set up and be right back. All right, now we're in business. Got my amplified input. So that's got me clipping, not at 10 watts, not even close to 10 watts. Well, 10 watts isn't critical here. So let's just back off to 8 volts there. That's 8 watts. Okay, now what I'm gonna do is move these traces so that they're as nearly perfectly superimposed as I can get. So let me get this centered here. So now we go to math mode. All right, go to my scope menu, waveform options, mathematics, A versus B. There we go. So the idea is for that to be a straight line and for me to potentially be able to adjust how straight that line is with the AC balance here. You do see that there is potentially a little bit of crossover distortion. So let's see, I can detect some distortion there, in other words, and so if I can detect some distortion, then perhaps I can eliminate at least some of that distortion with this adjustment. Let's give that a try.
Kind of what I'm looking for at this point is to see what, if any, effect I have whatsoever by adjusting this pot.
So I'm not really sure what it's supposed to look like here as I change this. Is it supposed to change the amount of crossover distortion, which would be a bit of a jog in the middle there? Am I even seeing anything like that? Am I supposed to be looking at how much the signal might be asymmetric? How much there might be sort of distortion of the ends there? Because the only guidance I have is that I'm supposed to be adjusting this to minimize the total harmonic distortion. And it doesn't tell me what sort of distortion I'm trying to minimize or what this sort of distortion I should be expecting to see. Maybe I can turn up the volume and see. I wonder if, so you see as I turn up the volume, I'm getting clipping. That's what that looks like. And I guess I can see whether this adjustment has any effect on the amount of that. I don't think it should. Crank up the volume a little more, see if I do see crossover distortion at some point. Okay, that's crossover distortion, that bit in the middle. Let's see if this adjustment does anything to that. I don't know, maybe? Not? I'm thinking that I might not be able to do the adjustment at all, so I'm just going to reset those to be in the middle of their range, and that should be that. I think we'll just call that good. Well, then I'm going to take this back upstairs and plug it in. I haven't listened to it in a while.